how to use machine learning prediction to define where to provide aid. I'm here at Click Connect. I'm here with Andrew Schroeder. He's the VP Research and Analysis at Direct Relief. Welcome, Andrew.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
So explain me, you had some great cases, how you use machine learning to define where to provide aid, and you predict exactly where it has the most effect.
So here we're talking about where we can invest solar energy as a form of aid. So where do we put solar panels on health centers to make sure they have resilient power in the face of disasters? Machine learning is a way to combine a bunch of different factors together from different data sources so that we can understand how they relate together and prioritize which health centers are most in need, which are the most affected by disaster, where which will produce the most energy. And then that gives us a sort of single view out of a very complex set of inputs for understanding priority of investment.
And I can imagine this is changing all the time, because when there's a flood somewhere, the whole situation changes. So is this something that's done in real time?
So we're not adjusting the model in real time, but we are reacting to the inputs of the model in real time. So when we look at a place that has been affected by a wildfire or a flood, we can see what the kind of projection ought to be for investment of resources for resilient power. I mean, we're using machine learning in other ways to be able to predict the demand for pharmaceuticals. So, you know, where is most likely to sort of need certain drugs given the population, given their previous ordering patterns. And that allows our pharmacy team to be able to place medicines with much more precision than they would otherwise be able to. And look at what is likely going to be consumed so that we're not throwing medicine away that could be used by communities in need.
And can you give a practical example where you use the data, where you said, okay, here we're going to invest in solar energy, or here we're going to ship the medicines?
Sure. I mean, the solar priority is actually probably the clearest example recently, where you know, Direct Relief has a fund called Power for Health, which is you know, aimed at building solar and battery installations for health centers in highly affected areas. And we've used sort of modeling from a combination of different sources that we were talking about here at Click Connect to be able to determine specific health centers in Northern California that were most affected by wildfires, that have populations that are tend to be older, have power-dependent medical devices, often have high rates of diabetes or other medication, or that have medications that need to be refrigerated. And so we've been able to put resources into those areas that build resilient power for them. And then long term, we're going to be doing that all over the place and working with health center partners at the association state level to make sure they're also able to solve the same kind of problems.
And do you have comparison from results when you provided the aid without the prediction and now with the prediction?
Yeah, I think that what we have is a much clearer understanding now of exactly what conditions actually most benefit from investment of solar resources. So, you know, Direct Relief has, you know, reasonable resources, but not anywhere close to what's required to actually, say, resolve the sort of access to energy problem across the entire primary healthcare safety net. Those sort of very specific investments need to be made with high confidence that it's explainable in terms of sort of why those priorities exist and why hundreds of other facilities did not receive resources. And then similarly, I think one of the points of emphasis is that data itself is a form of aid. And so the analytics models that help Direct Relief to make decisions about where to put resources also help other organizations like the state associations for primary health care, the national association, even our public sector partners, to understand where those priorities are sort of greatest.
So you share already the models?
Yeah, we share the models results. And we share the research and make sure that we're sort of always one among many partners that are trying to resolve this problem, because, you know, the climate crisis is not a sort of one shot deal. Like, nobody can solve it alone. So that's one of the keys to making shareable easily translatable analysis that anyone can use in sort of thinking through the same kind of problems.
It's great to see how machine learning prediction can help in our sustainable environment and sustainable world.
It's absolutely essential, and I think it's only going to get better. So,
thanks a lot, Andrew.
Thank you so much.
And thank you for watching here from Click Connect in Orlando. Thank you.
Thank you.